Good morning to our Indian continent from Mount Sinai Medical Center. We welcome all of you for this live case relay from Mount Sinai, sponsored by Sun Pharma. Dr. Dhiman Kali and Dr. Suman Chatterjee will take you through this particular case and take the input. Can you hear us well and see all my team here with Dr. Keeney on the left side and rest of it?
Yes, I mean, we can listen to you and we can see you also very well. And
beautiful.
Very, very good morning to you, Dr. Annapurna Keeney, and all the team members to see some beautiful demonstration and to learn something. It's always fascinating, Shamin, to see you and Dr. Annapurna Keeney working together. And I had the pleasure of chairing several sessions in CSI. I remember about 12 years back, you were showing one case of impella with ALV of 25%, and you didn't hesitate to do rota in LAD in two diagonals and to stain them beautifully in a copybook fashion. So congratulations and hats to you. And I have with me Suman Chatterjee. He has completed his DM about 2 years back, and he has been working with me and he's doing very well. And we'll do the, you know, things in an Indian style in the next patient, and we'll be eagerly waiting to see your case. Thank you.
And fantastic. And our memory coming to the BM Birla Institute a few times. So we go to our this. We go to this case presentation
I also
now.
Remember, Shamin. I also remember one of the circumflex was occluded proximally just at the beginning. And how you jumped and changed in with 30 seconds. And you opened, you passed the wire immediately. Dr. A.B. Mehta was with you.
Yep.
It was a NIC live demonstration. Thank you very much. Yeah. Nice seeing this.
Okay, fantastic.
Thank
so, the today it's support event supported by Sun Pharmaceutical. And here are our myself, Dr. Keeney, and Dr. Dhiman Kali. We, as you said, moderator being Suman Chatterjee. So, just to say about Dr. Dhiman Kali, is a clearly senior interventional cardiologist and director of cardiology at BM Birla Heart Research Center in Kolkata. He's a chairman of National Interventional Council and one of the highest operator in terms of intervention in the Eastern India. And of course, expert in performing angioplasties, complex CTOs and so. I had a pleasure working with him many times, physically and secondly in various sessions. And today's moderator is Suman Chatterjee, our recent DM graduate, also associate consultant, interventional cardiologist at BM Birla Heart Research Center, Kolkata. So welcome both of you for this event. And we take you through, this is a live case number 3 from Sun Pharmaceutical. Fantastic. Welcome all. And this is a 58-year-old patient who has a long-standing history of CAD, a few PCIs. Last one was about 2011. The presented actually last month with a chest pain and positive stress test, had two vessel disease of the RCA, multi-layer DS ISR of the RCA and CT of the mid LAD. We did, because of multi-layer ISR, we did IVUS, there were three layers. We just did a brachytherapy after rotational atherectomy, and patient is here today for the CTO of the mid LAD, which we are going to show you very quickly. So basically, we always put in our educational point of view that anytime you do any intervention, follow with the latest guidelines of the appropriate use criteria. So if this patient we put in, who has a positive stress test and has a mid-LAD total and is on double antiplatelet ischemic therapy, will fit into this appropriate case. So now we'll ask Dr. Keeney to take us through how we are going to deal with this CTO and what it is now.
So this is normal. We have a LV, near normal LV function. This is the right coronary artery, you know, patent stents. Very faint.
IVBT. Last time we just did IVBT and it looks very good now.
Here you have very faint collaterals to the LAD. So this is the dual injection we have. Always you inject the feeding vessel first and then you go through the next vessel. If you see here during the injection, you don't see a lot of apical LED, but you start seeing the LED later on when you inject on the left system, which could be bridge collateral from septal to septal. That's why you probably are seeing the apical LED way later on, only when you inject the antegrade vessel itself, not the retrograde. So the goal here is same. I think always we have taught that when you are dealing with the CTO, the always antegrade approach should be the first that you need to try, the very few indication where you would go retrograde. So here we will start the antegrade approach. The way to start here would be that you go over the wire catheter, so you will have ways to change the various CTO wires that we will describe as we go through the case. What we have selected is a fine cross, which is our workhorse, what I would say, over the wire catheter. The various other catheters that you can use, we have Turnpike that is available, LP. Turnpike actually have six different catheters, but we like to use LP, and then we have Teleport. We can show you those things that we are those are available here. I'm not sure what available in India, but these are the various. No. And then we
they all are available there. Yeah, okay. Also yeah.
They all are available.
Yeah, See again the catheter. Now see that the big challenge here is that where is the entry point
of proximal the CTO? Cap. Yeah.
You see the proximal cap, very ambiguous. Despite you later on see. Trying to see the filling FSL, but there is a gap in between. And the proximal stent in the LED diagonal is completely patent. That was done 2008. And it's a Zion's stent in that proximal LED. And that is completely patent. And the key is that we still don't have a clear-cut cap. So a very ambiguous cap is not tapered, totally blunt. But we have not taken another picture. We can do one injection antegrade only, right? You don't need the retrograde for that. Okay. You need a long Sine injection with a little magnified view to see where is the cap. Okay. We are going to do one more injection here.
Go.
Sorry. Yeah. So it still didn't help us much.
No, it will.
It's really a very complex CTO lesion.
So yeah. So JCTO is three.
It's a long thing.
It's a long CTO lesion.
Ready? I think just at the that level of the septal, the first picture which we had. We probably should start poking there. We do have an old picture in a particular case. It's a good LED size vessel. Now looks like diffusely diseased, probably occluded for last 5, 6, 7 years. But it was ischemic. It's a normal ejection fraction and it was ischemic both in the inferior and the anterior wall. So RCA we have fixed with a brachytherapy, which looks very good, rotablation, cutting balloon and brachytherapy. I know a lot of people will now in India using IVL. For this kind of purpose, but key is that for recurrent DES ISR multi-layer, we have done we prefer brachytherapy in those cases, and that is what we have published. What has happened is once you do this case without brachytherapy, chances of event rate in about 15 months is about 48%. With the brachytherapy, number goes down to about 18%. It's still high, but key is that it decreased by 1/3. And then now question comes, if patient comes back after brachytherapy, we do not have a drug-coated balloon available in United States yet, but that will be another, instead of brachytherapy, I would say that for recurrent ISR, your first approach with a multi-layer, in India, everybody uses the drug-coated balloon, and maybe... Yeah. Dr. Kali, you can comment on it, your experience, if you have multi-layer of two or three layers and then you use a cutting the drug-coated balloon, what are your data, what is your success rate and patency rate for the future? Right now, we are starting with a fielder and fine cross.
I think, sure. Okay, so I think the, balloon-coated, the drug-coated balloons are very good and the results are also equally good. And I think there are multiple drug-coated balloons from different companies available, and I think they do quite well with good long-term data.
So one of the challenges which we always know when you have a CTO, that if you have a side branch, like here, you see the second septal, I think the wire will just keep going to the second septal. This is the fielder. Fielder is a polymer jacketed wire. I mean, the first wire that you want to always try, that if you think that there could be some micro channels, could be fielder, could be whisper, could be fielder XT, any of this wire. I always say start with the wire of your choice, because you want to just make sure you familiarize yourself with 3 to 4 wires. You don't need to have the whole armamentarium of the CTO wires.
So what will be your next wire now? You have brought your device to the CTO area.
Fine cross is not going. Yeah. Okay, now it went further. Yeah. You see, it's just going to the septal.
Yeah.
I will try to change. Yeah, I'll try to change into the Gaia. Now, what has happened is Ashayi has come with what is called as the Gaia Next. We used to have Gaia 1, 2, 3, so same, your torque, 1-to-1 torque, everything used to be very good with the Gaia, initial Gaia wire. But Gaia, right? The tip, yeah. Gaia 1, Gaia 2, Gaia 3, we have Gaia 3. Gaia Next. There's no need for curve.
Okay.
Already has it. So if you see there, Gaia 1 used to be a tip load of 1.7. Gaia 2 used to be 3.5. And Gaia 3 is 4.5. Gaia 2 is 3.5. So you need to, I think as a CTO operator, you need to know your wires with the tip load so you can then decide what you want to do. So for the drilling, which is here, that you want to pierce the proximal cap, you start with the low tip load. So now the Gaia Next, what they have made, they have what is called as a new technology, what they call it as a X-strand coil, that there is a hollow coil with multiple ropes around. All these, I think, CTO wires that have been made by Ashayi, they have the technology, what is called as a composite core, where you have a single coil, and then there is a roping of a second coil around, which what it does, it helps better torque and better maneuverability of these wires in this kind of a case. Now, there's calcium. That is why you need one anti-trapping is very important, that you are in a calcific lesion, you're trying to drill through it, you don't want the wire get stuck there. So this technology that you have created is very good. So what I have selected actually is Gaia Next 3, which is about 6 grams now. Now, the old wires used to be Miracle, Miracle Bros. They used to be Miracle 3, yeah. Tip Load 3, Miracle 6, and Miracle 9. Gaia comes with a pre-made curve.
So, it's like...
Now, even this
really
is going into the...
wire, and now also we go for the...
You are also using the Gaia as a Bain CTO wires there?
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Next case will show that we have used Gaia 2 in that case. Yes. Not as difficult as your case. It was little easier than that 1-year-old CTO, almost 1-year-old. And, we also prefer Gaia. Because
let me change the curve.
Very good wire.
Wait, don't do anything. Yep. Let me change. I have to change the curve. This came with a pre-made curve, which is not enough. It's so still going into the septal.
Exactly.
Second septal.
Yeah, key is that...
Annapurna, would you mind to show the curve? Because there are many PGTs watching it. Because Gaia has already a curve. So what sort of curve you are giving if you project it in a way?
We'll do it secondary curve. So we can show that. Yeah. So means another 45 degree angle.
You saw that?
Sure.
So it is very minute. It's not there. It's like 1.5 millimeter.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
But I gave a secondary curve now to see if I'll get into the septal. Now, if I cannot go, then I'll have to change to a different wire. Now, why also these Gaia wires are important? Because this Gaia wire is tapered. So if you take Gaia Next 1 is tapered to 0.001. You know, usual wires are 0.014. This is tapered to 0.0012 Gaia 3 that I'm working on.
Need a torquer?
No. Let me see.
Okay. So, key is that we have to engage into a stump of that CTO. And I think this is the direction.
Yeah, we are in the right direction. It's a very difficult journey, of course. Good. Yeah.
You take a little picture.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, maybe that's okay. We don't know. I mean, you have to do. We have to go to RAO view a little more. RAO 24.
We are not RAO. We are RAO 24.
Yeah, we are same, actually. Yeah. We are exactly in that view. So you have to advance a little more, and then we do contralateral injection is not going to work in this particular case. But I always say that once you decide for CTO, make sure you have a contralateral injection, even if looks by the bridge collateral, because many times you'll fill up the proximal cap and then bridge collateral will disappear. So in this particular case, we have a contralateral injection. It's not a case for retrograde because we didn't see any vessel filling, and we are hoping just to rely on the bridge collateral, although we have, as mentioned, that we have RCA contralateral injection also.
Okay, I think we change some dye. Okay. It's not the way the LED is going, I think.
Yeah. No, LED probably is going this way.
It's going well, yeah. It's going well, yeah. It has crossed the distal cap, I think.
Yeah. Go to a little more RAO.
No, contralateral.
Okay. We do both?
No, just RCA.
Okay, good. You want to do little cine? No, RCA catheter is out, I think. Let's see 1 second. Yeah. Yeah. So we are going to do contralateral. See if we can see a little bit there now.
Okay.
Good. Okay. You want to magnify on this side?
No need.
Okay.
Let's do it. I don't think. Let's see. Don't see.
How is the passage, Annapurna? Do you find any difficulty going integrated till now?
No, it's going okay. Plus, we don't see any ectopics.
Let's do the integrate injection, and clearly that you are in the lumen. The absence of ectopy tells you that it's in the lumen. Okay, let's do take a picture integrate now.
Yeah.
Okay, we are doing integrate little delayed shot.
And the movement of the TP is also good.
Yeah. Yes, it's in the right direction. Good.
Yeah.
So far looks Gaia 3 seems to be heading in the right direction. It's a long way. Lot of diffuse disease there.
Yeah.
Okay, let me see. I think we are in the...
We are in the lumen there, yes. And now same drill, kind of clockwise turn to whatever over the...
Can they focus on my hand movements here?
Yeah, they're there.
They're showing it?
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
I think we are good, SS.
Yeah, good.
So what I needed to, I mean, if you are telling me there are PG students or the fellows, you see here, these two fingers and your thumb. Yeah. This is very important, and you go backward, forward. You see this? We go backward, forward like this. This is the movement you need to do. And of course, I mean, I do not use torquer, but everybody else uses torquer. If you are going to use a torquer, just gentle. Don't keep turning, twisting one side, other side, one side. That is when what we call it gets trapped. The wire gets trapped. Sometimes even the tip gets broken in the lesion. So has to be gentle. You see,
I know that the Japanese operators, when they come, they teach everybody drill, keep rotating. So we are not teaching that. We don't say, because that's really associated with a little more trouble in our opinion. And so...
Now you see how I'm advancing the catheter? over the wire. This is a fine cross. Any of the catheter you see there, I'm rotating a little bit and with my left hand keep advancing it. So it is moving forward, gentle, and make sure the guide is always there. Good.
We need action length.
Run through.
Run through. Action length, run through first. No, it's the same little clockwise as long as you have not done more than 8 to 10 turns.
Yeah.
So if you have done more than 10 turns, then you do little unclock. But otherwise, one direction is perfectly fine.
Yeah.
And I would say the limit is 10. Once you start doing it, I have seen cases in the live cases many times, even these catheters, whether Corsair or Fine Cross broken off. Make a call. Yeah.
Okay, sir.
Okay. So now we are, what we are going to do, using the exchange length wire.
Now, once you have, you wanted rotor?
No, but let's see first. I've been not sure for completely.
You want to inject a little bit from there?
No. We don't inject.
Okay.
Okay. So we are going, we have gone quite far, although, and we change now.
Okay. Ready? Good.
So this was the Gaia 3 next. That was, had made this area go further. It's just an anti-grade, some kind of faint bridge collaterals. And we are going to advance this and then we see whether we should do rota or not. It definitely looked calcific, but we are not sure in the exact lumen. That's why we did not change to the rota wire yet.
Diffuse disease of the apical LED.
Good. That's good. Yeah, as you right said also, the many time buckling means that you are in some subintimal space.
Yeah.
But key is that absence of PVC is telling you that you are going into the lumen. Now, a lot of people get too much carried away with that we are, I am a subintimalizer, that's okay. As long as you are a little further down, you are in the main lumen.
Yeah.
Because there is a whole concept of the string ray based on going subintimal and go distally. So now we are ready. One second, that's let's give a little vasodilator.
But I think the goal as a CTO operator should be that you enter in the proximal cap and you exit at the distal cap. So that you are only traversing the CTO that is totally occluded. Otherwise, what you're going to do, if you do subintimal and do like what the peripheral vascular disease want to do, where they go subintimal, come back, the length of the stent that you're going to use will be way longer and they have a, you know, restenosis.
We can do a 1.5 bus. Yeah. And same thing, the the re-entry devices, by definition, have a little higher restenosis. I think it's a lot of diffusely disease with moderately calcified. I'll be in favor of using a 1.5 bar.
No, I would 1.25.
Yeah, 1.25. That's
you
okay
want
too.
To or just balloon it?
Yeah, no. Looks good. Yeah. Okay. We are going to change to a rota wire and... 1.25, I mean, question, is it a
must? The question, what he wanted is if we were able to see LED via the retrograde injection, I would have been comfortable to go with 1.5 bar. The reason for using 1.5 bar also, I think you have seen us teach that when we are using this catheter, over the wire catheter, and that catheter had crossed the lesion, you know, you can use bigger than 1.25 bar, which means 1.5 bar is okay. Since it was a CTO, I'm a little concerned. I said, let's just go 1.25.
Yeah, and that is okay also because our goal is here to just do a little modification so that good expansion happens. And this was even back then, we have the angiogram on this particular case. It was done in 2009 and that time was mildly calcific and normal. That LED was normal about 10 years ago. Normal means mildly diffuse disease only. Yeah, ready? Good. I'm taking out.
Okay, good. Take it out.
Okay.
So if there is any chance or question in your mind that there, that you were subintimal at any part of the traversing this CTO, then rotational atherectomy is not a good choice. The risk of perforation is very high.
Yeah. So and other question is, lot of people.
The journey,
I agree with you. The way the wire went.
Very smooth. Yeah.
Yes. Yeah. The way the wire went.
It was
and
very smooth.
Yeah, you were asking me the question also, which is very important. What am I feeling? The tactile sensation when you're operating is the key. Yeah, that's what you were asking me.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. And you have gone like a very easy lesion. That shows your expertise, your anatomical expertise. You have traveled in a very smooth way, as if it's a very easy one. And I was seeing the confidence, because that's also very important. And as Shamin rightly told, that we differ a little from the Japanese operators because they are a little more aggressive than us and they want to drill. And yeah. In that, we have seen that sometimes perforation has occurred and yep. patients from our cath lab has to be transferred to the operation theater. But what Shamin is preaching is very good, that he takes care of the journey and he takes care of safety as well.
Yeah. So that is what I would say, that respect to Japanese colleagues. They are great. But yeah, I can tell you, their only problem is the patient, they don't think about the patient. They will do an 8-hour CTO intervention. And so, second point I want to emphasize in this case, a lot of people, when they are not sure they're in the lumen, they inject through the over-the-wire system. But my question is, I've seen cases when you are subintimal or a little bit tip, you create an extensive dissection. By definition, we never, I would say maybe in my lifetime, two times or so, I have injected through the over-the-wire system. What you need to do is go further down, do the kind of Fogarty, pull back, and then take the injection. You will be always able to see the distal vasculature. So we, as a principle, do not inject through the over-the-wire our catheter. So that is the key. Okay. Now we are ready. This is a Rota Pro, which is not available. Yeah, Rota Pro is not available in India yet. It soon will be, because the old classical device is being discontinued. They don't have any equipment about it, just like an old car. The new device, the new equipment is not there. So this is the Rota Pro, which everything is on this. There is no pedal. And it has a, I did work, this is the design. I went to their factory. It comes automatic, set at 155,000 RPM. You can adjust it, but as soon as you'll see, we get ready. We should be, one camera should be focusing on the speed here. So it will set at 155. And idea is, so not much fluctuation, because some people go 180, some go 140. We felt, let's go to 155. And this is where you are going to see. And we have to check the speed. While you're checking the speed, make sure you're holding it up. Okay. Ready? So we wanted to just show the screen. Yeah, good. So we are going to check the speed now. See? Good. It's all set. No need to move your tachometer. Right now you're there and we are ready to start advancing. What we had done all the time, push and pull. They still don't have the monorail, and I don't think they'll ever have a monorail. Still have the over-the-wire system, but they do making some more design changes in the wire. Becomes a little more one-to-one torqueable, but that is still, initially they made a Rota Elite, which had to be discontinued because it got a little trouble, and they're coming with the new wire design, which you will be able to see. Right now we have only Rota Floppy and Rota Extra Support, and we use Rota Floppy by and large, Extra Support only in austere lesions and very distal lesions. Good.
Now the bar, you know, traversed the left main to proximal LAD very easily. If there was any kind of tension, or you think that the burr is not going any further, I think you can always stop just at the austral left main, or just at the proximal left main. Do your three steps, which we always teach. You got to remove the tension from the burr before you start burring. So the three steps are, you have the knob, you release the knob, you move the knob backward forward. This way, so any tension between the Teflon sheath and the burr. So essentially, there are three components now in the Rota here. You have your wire, you have the Teflon sheath, you have the burr, and after the burr, there is Teflon sheath. You have three things. So when I did this, the Teflon sheath and the burr, any tension between the two is gone. Then what I do is, you have the Y connector, open the Y connector, I'm moving the burr on the Y connector. You see that? So there's movement there.
Show the fluoro also, on one side fluoro please. And that you have to be transmitted. Yeah, good. Yeah. Very good. Now. Yeah.
Yeah. So you see that?
Yeah.
So I'm making some movement here, backward, forward, and then you see there's something, the burr. So essentially the burr and the wire, any tension between the two are removed. So the burr and the wire at the Y connector, the knob is between the Teflon sheath and the burr. All the, any kind of tension that has been created while we are going up has been removed. And the last step is that you are on the dyna, And what is Dyna? I will tell you, is that you go on the Dyna. So when you go on Dyna, the burr starts rotating, but it is a safety feature that the burr rotates only at 70,000 RPM. So even if the burr is supposed to jump, it will jump with a small RPM, which means the risk of dissection, that's number one, or the perforation is very low. Okay. So now everything is ready. We'll start burring. So burring is the same. You start here, and Pablo is going to tell me the numbers. Slow pecking motion. So this is the key. You see my fingers? Gentle forward motion, come back. Forward motion, come back. So this is called pecking, like a woodpecker, the bird woodpecker. Pecking, come back. And I'll stop here. So that what happens, you come back so to the so-called normal looking part of the vessel and you wait. Now when I go, I'll go directly to the area where I stopped burring.
So about 20 second burring at any given time. And always looking at the hemodynamic blood pressure, systolic has to be more than 100. Always say never burr when systolic is in double digits.
Now, I don't have to come all the way to the proximal LAD where I initially started. Then you lose a lot of your time plus the distance that has been traversed by the burr. So now I will go to the second point where I stopped burring, because I probably will complete the burring at this time. Good? I think so.
Yeah.
So now I'll do a polish run. You see that polish run?
Yeah.
Good. Good.
And any time when you have to advance the burr, you can put the brake, release, and then advance the wire. So you can just go flora. So we can say, if the wire has come back and you want to advance, go to your speed. Yeah. So you have to, that brake release and wire can be repositioned or pull back and push here and so forth. Just wanted to let you know. Good. Okay.
Ready?
Now, once you're ready, you're Dyna glide. You come back in the guide. You want to go distal or no?
No. Okay. I think there's no lesion there.
Yeah. It's a diffusely diseased vessel there, yeah. But it has to be a 3 millimeter. I know that this patient has a last angiogram. It's a 3 millimeter vessel. Big vessel.
Now, hemodynamics are good. No EKG changes.
Pull the wire.
I mean, very rarely.
Very good.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, very rarely, because you have to remember CTO could have, CTO are known to have some thrombus. And when in the setting of thrombus, you're doing rotational atherectomy, you may develop a slow flow and you will see EKG changes in that setting. So you got to be cautious at that time. So differential diagnosis would be when you have EKG changes, chest pain, is that you created a dissection and there's a flow issue, or in this case, probably thrombus has gone downstream. So you be ready for that, which means we have a balloon here as well as vasodilator therapy. We are going to start now. You give?
Yeah.
Yeah. So we gave verapamil, we gave some nitro, blood pressure is okay, and we're just going to take an anti-grade picture. Okay, we are seeing the LAD better. You want to go side by side?
Yeah, side by side. So question is now, so if you think there is a dissection, you can you already have your over-the-wire system and you can go through it. And change it to your present wire, but otherwise go side by side. We prefer to go side by side. It's a that area you can see, and we have a balloon ready. It's a 2.530.
So Shamin, do you think that this RotaPro is much better than the previous edition?
Yeah, actually, at one point, I would say was not, but we have made a lot of changes that yes, because assembly becomes simpler. Now there is a cart, everything with the nitrogen tank and so available. So just move the cart and you don't have to worry about all the connections. And so it's much easier to, initially we were having trouble, there was no resistance handle. Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so this is the run through wire. Going side by side. Run through wire is a workhorse wire in our lab. So what is your workhorse wire, Dr. Kali?
We also use lot of run through, but we also use Xion Blue.
Okay.
Xion Blue.
Yeah. Yeah, a lot of people use Cyan Blue actually. But at one point, Cyan Blue was the number one wire of Abbott in terms of use. But yes, run through. We actually were the first one in the United States back in 2007-8 when it just came in the market. We used to be BMW, and then overnight we switched to this wire. And one of the advantage of this is reasonable torque, and more important, it just does not cause very rare chance of perforation. Okay, yeah. We are going up.
So I went back to the angiogram, and I, you know, we have to be cautious with the length of the stent to see where actually I could see the distal LED properly, and that's where I think we can see the distal LED. So we just start ballooning there, and we come proximal. Hopefully after that we'll get a better flow.
And leave the rotavire for the time being, so it will modify your cutting balloon also type situation. And second is, if you are not able to crack the lesion, you can always upgrade your bar. Because 6 French will take 1.75. We use only 1.25.
Sir, what is the size of the balloon?
It's a 2.5 30 millimeter NC.
2.5 30. And at what pressure you give?
And we actually distally was about 12 and proximally 16, and we are ready to take a picture now. Good. Yeah.
Oh, so two, you want 275?
Yeah.
30.
275. No.
So you start at that subtle.
275. Yeah. 275. 38 zines.
Sir, one question is there,
yeah.
Sir.
Yes.
In CTO, listen, we always thought that they go for a small diameter balloon and then serially, gradually upgrades the balloon diameter from low to high.
Very good point. Yeah. Here is a little different. What we did is, because we had done additional intervention, that is a rotational atherectomy. So once you have done rotational atherectomy, you have bypassed those steps. That is the key. Okay. But otherwise, yes. So that is the right approach. We got to see the distal vessel, and so we start with a small 2.0 or 1.5 and then go to 2.5 and so. But in this case, we have already done rotational atherectomy with a 1.25 bar. We saw the vessel, and now you just want to see what should be your stent length. We are soon starting the Zions 48 trial. We don't have the Zions more than 38 here. Only we have Synergy 48. And this is
we don't have Synergy 48 in our lab. We have 48 giants. It's reversed. And one of the things, Shamin, that regarding Cyan Blue, the reusability is very good. And if we go to the side branch after jailing, the wear comes out.
You want to pull back?
Yeah, so little bit. Yeah, good. Now take the once we have get the stent there, we are ready to we have to remove the rotavire now.
The rotavire, which are side by side, remove it, and now we'll go up with the stent. Going back to the question that we should go with a small balloon in the CTO, you know, like here, you know, we have a transit catheter. So we cross the CTO, and then the transit catheter was able to traverse through the CTO, and we reach the distal cap and the distal vessel. If that happens, you can go with a 2 or 2.5. Balloon. You don't have to start with a smaller size balloon. The smaller size balloon we have is 1.0, 1.2, 1.5, 2.0 balloons. So then they also come with 8 millimeter length, or you have 12 millimeter length. Suppose you know that you have crossed the lesion. Okay, you have crossed the lesion, but then your transit catheter does not cross the CTO. Then what you do is a wire trap. Two ways of taking it out. Either you wire trap at the guide, or you use duck wire, so you remove the transit catheter. Once that is done, then you make a decision. If you are very confident, okay, you are very confident with your contralateral injection that your distal wire is in the vessel, then you can think of doing laser atherectomy. Okay, because we can't do rota because you need rota wire. You can do laser atherectomy, which will go on the CTO wire that you have. If you don't have that, then you go with your balloon. That's where you start going. 1.0 balloon, 1.2 balloon, 1.5 balloon, or 1.0 balloon goes, you can go to 1.5 balloon, then 2.0, and make sure then you go with the 1:1 vessel size and finally stent. That's the strategy. So you want a 3-5?
Yeah, 3-0. Now I think we put a 3-0. 3-0, 32, 33.
I know we'll lose. You don't need that long. Okay. 3-0, 3-5. It's approximately 3-5.
Okay, 3.2533. So we are now putting a second stent, 3.25.
So what also we have done is, because fellows always have a lot of questions about wires and which wire to use when. So I have two here. Okay, he's my current cath research fellow. He actually has done a great job. We are going to come up with the next app, which is called the Guide Wire Aid. Okay, all the wires that are available in the market will be described, various scenarios, when to use them, all the things that I have just spoken to you, everything will be available on the website that we have created, which is on the cardiologyapps.com, and the app will be available. So people will be people can go through that, understand the various wires, you know, the properties of the wires, and which scenario to use them. That's another educational tool that will be coming shortly.
Nice.
And we'll show you some of the apps in the end of this. We do after the diagonal.
Some
diagonal is open. Yeah, good. Yeah, little
some die.
Show it. Yeah,
pull no, back. No. Yeah.
Little die again.
You think
take
we
a
are
picture here, right?
Yeah.
Good.
We just want to make sure the distal part is overlapped.
Yeah, it is.
We're good.
Yeah, good.
Okay, nice. Go up.
Okay.
You want to do IVUS at the end?
Yeah, we are going to do IVUS. This is a 3.2533.
Now, other thing people may teach you in the various courses is, once they have done a balloon or they have done rota before they stent, they always like to IVUS because one, you don't know actual size of the vessel. And you have seen, I think both myself, Dr. Sharma, we are trained ourselves using the vessel size eyeball. You know, we eyeball the vessel size and we place the stent based on that rather than imaging. But I know the newer generation is want to train with by using IVUS. After they go open the CTO, they want to IVUS to understand the vessel size. That teaching is happening in many of the other courses. So just wanted to let you know. But we will do IVUS post to show you that the stent is well opposed, which is a good thing because we have used two long stents.
Yeah.
That will then determine the length of the
antiplatelet
treatment.
Yeah, and that's a very important point. And I just want to say that how our strategy have changed, that just to, if those who remember the data of the iLumen 3, where the primary endpoint was the stent, minimum stent lumen, that was identical in the OCT group and angiography group. That means that what we do at present, modified the plaque, put a right size stent, post dilate, angiographically we look at the same. Yes, what OCT did, it found some more the lesions, some dissections and so on and so forth, better than angiogram. But question is, there was no clear cut difference in the outcome. Biggest point is, the main point of the trial was the minimum stent lumen diameter, which was identical between two groups. Yeah, distal vessel required a little rehabilitation. You want to put a balloon there or distal?
I don't know. I think vasodilators will take care of it, no?
We'll do a little vasodilators,
I don't want to balloon it's not necessary.
Yeah.
So we'll just give vasodilators, what we say, give some psychotherapy to this vessel.
Rehabilitation.
Yeah.
Rehabilitate the distal vasculature. A lot of people will give a nipride.
Give some nipride.
Yeah. Yes.
Shami,
yes, Dr. Kali.
What
percentage
of cases, total cases, you use IVUS or OCT? And what is the percentage of OCT or IVUS? More of OCT or more of IVUS?
Yeah,
and
so
which
very
one
good.
You like also?
Yeah, very good point. So I would say that this has been changing. We again are not an imaging lab. We are physiologically driven. 62% of our cases are done with the FFR or IFR guidance, 90% FFR, 20%, 10 to 15% IFR. But imaging point of view, imaging is in single digits in Mount Sinai cath lab. So anywhere between 5 to 8%. And of that, majority, particularly left main, we mandate on those where we use the IVUS. So I think OCT we use more specific, instant restenosis, we have brachytherapy and so, and there we using OCT. So I would say that of the, let's say, average 8% we have, it will be 5% IVUS, 3% OCT in our lab.
So for the OCT, what we can say, you know, the resolution is great. I will tell you the difference. difference. It's a color TV versus black and white TV. That's what you have to think of. But if you need to know, because since the, you know, IVUS, people are more used to having seen IVUS because it's been out for many years, and OCT is difficult. Now, OCT cannot be done in every vessel. If you have a small vessel, 2.5 and less, you have a large vessel, 4.0 and bigger, you don't see a good resolution. You cannot use in the osteal lesions. And and osteal RCA, this kind of areas you cannot use. Patients with high creatinine you cannot use because you are giving so much dye when you are doing the OCT. But otherwise, you know, it's all what you get used to. So also again, I'm telling you, we have an app called Octade where this OCT discussion a lot, who, when to use it, how to use it, and most important is the various kind of OCT images have been discussed there.
I think distal we have to rehabilitate with a small balloon. Give me still, a 2 or 20. Yeah.
Distal with a small 1.5 or 2 millimeter.
Or 2. Yeah, 2 millimeter 20 compliant.
I think still need to Shamin and Annapurna both. Yeah. Shamin, sometimes we find that when we measure the FFR simultaneously in the abort machine, we can see the RFR as well. And there is discrepancy between the two. Recently, we had a negative FFR and we had a positive RFR. RFR was 0.79.8 and FFR was 0.89. So what do you decide regarding the vascularizing the disease?
So very good point, very good point. I don't think we know much about it, but there are some published literature now that if there is a discordance in the FFR and IFR, it seems to be that IFR trumps the overall outcome. So your FFR is positive but IFR negative, or your IFR is negative but FFR positive, your probably IFR determines more long-term outcome. So RFR, there are very few data available for the RFR at present. So I would not be able to comment on it. We have used just very few cases. I would still so just go with the your
FFR.
You know, FFR, but more importantly, I can FFR tell you that that clinically if you felt this patient is symptomatic, you have a 70-80% lesion. Yeah. It's a, then you decide, you know, this the whole area. We all know that even with the FFR of 0.8, let's say 0.82, 0.84, event rate is not 0%. This is still 5-6%. So those are the borderline cases. So where clinical decision.
I want to take out the wire now.
Yeah, it should take the wire out. Yeah, no, but not wire. I was. You have to pull back a little bit.
Oh yeah, no. Some dye. So I know distal vessel is okay. It's okay.
Yeah, good.
Okay, give the IVUS now.
Yeah. Yes, Dr. Kali, you have some question.
So Shamim. Shamin, you were using 2 millimeter balloon. What pressure did you give in
I went only 6 atmosphere, very low pressure.
Six.
So it will be okay. So we get a little nitride. Let's get a nitride now. This is the case, require nitride. Give 20 of Lasix too.
Yeah.
Okay, so now we are doing the IVUS.
Because it is an athletic artery. Yeah.
What's the dye and all that? Okay, we're going to show the IVUS.
I have one question, sir. Before rotablation, do not dilate the vessel, or it depends upon the situation of the blood vessel size or the pre-ballooning scenario of the blood vessel.
Right.
Either you people regularly pre-dilate before rota or not?
Actually, yeah, always. No, post-dilate. No, not pre.
We
not
never, pre. No pre-dilation.
No.
Before introducing the rotor bar, pre-dilation is a common maneuver or not?
I would say by almost teaching is that almost contraindicated. So do not do balloon. So what you can do, as I mentioned, in this total occlusion vessel, put your fine cross off your over the wire system one or two times. Kind of you had done the Fogarty, then take a picture. And you saw that your wire is in the lumen, go ahead and do the rota. So no pre-dilatation. From our point of view, pre-dilatation before rota.
Okay, we are pulling back the IVUS now.
We are ready with the IVUS now. Okay, we may require a little push here.
No need.
Further expansion.
No. It's well expanded.
No, but still
fully opposed.
Okay. Flora, where are we?
Yeah, it's fully opposed. Well opposed everywhere.
Yes.
No, but
Kiss, start talking.
I'm in good shape. expanded, still 1 layer, more expanded.
No, we not should not do anything. It looks very good on the IVUS.
Okay. So we'll get a knife right ready?
Good. Yeah, yeah, we have.
Okay, good. So everything out with the wire
out. Stop here.
Yeah. So we are going to give a little more knife right now. And we have a 5 to 7 minutes to discuss a little bit on the CTO, one or two the important papers, the recent ones, and we'll talk about our app. Where is the knife right? We have it. Good. Okay. So now we are done. Get a little knife right here for the distal vasculature and go into the RAO view. Because really apical LED, you cannot see in the RAO. You need to go to the in apicranial, you need to go into the good RAO caudal view. Make sure your balloon is ready in case we have to go back in. Oh, good.
That's very good.
Yeah. Let's go to the RAO.
Actually, what's going to happen, many times I can tell you the distal vessel will get better, improve, because now your antegrade flow is good. When they come back, the vessel plumps up.
Good. That. Good. Yeah, so
looks
this,
very good.
Oh, this one is going to get better, yes. So don't go further, don't do unnecessary things and put a stent in the small. We just saw it, there was a little distal problem with outflow. We brought a 2O balloon at 6 atmosphere. It's a diffusely diseased vessel. It's going to grow with a vasodilatation further on.
No, so let us say the total dye as well as the radiation. So we always follow every case, the amount of radiation that a patient receives, every case, not just CTO. So here was about 2.3 milligray only. So, yeah. But then, and the total contrast both with the dual injection was 140 cc. Fluoro time, 25 minutes.
So show it here.
Very well done.
In front
Excellent.
Of the camera.
Excellent.
Yeah, yeah.
What was
yeah.
the fluoro time you mentioned?
Yeah. Right here.
The 25 fluoro time, 25 minutes, 59 seconds to be precise.
Yeah. Okay. Air karma 2.3 depth, because you know now it has
air karma yeah.
in our sky guidelines and particularly our New York State. We have to present this, and if your depth, air karma and depth, you know, become more than 5 and more than 15. We actually have to document in the chart more than 15 need a skin consultation by a dermatologist, because those people are coming back. So this has really taken a very serious issue, which we never used to worry about. But definitely now we are very much concerned. So with that note, I just want to go through a few of our new coming app and one or two data of the CTO, which we have at present. And this is basically wanted to say that JCTO score is the one we routinely use, right? In the based on the 5 important predictors, which is the entry shape, tapered versus blunt, calcification, band, occlusion length, and retry lesion. And as you saw, a score could be from 0 to 5. And of course, that when you have an advanced score of more than 4, your success rate becomes only 15-20%. So now the European guys, from the Euro CTO registry, have come with a new score called CASEL, Euro CTO of 20,000 patients. And they've taken various other points and they come up with this word called CASEL, which takes 2 clinical factors and 4 angiographic factors. The CABG prior always have a high chance of failure. Age, more than 70, stump anatomy, same, blunt versus ambiguous or tapered, tortuosity, length of occlusion and extent of calcification, and you get a score from 0 to 6. And what is shown is basically that there is a good correlation. Once you have a higher score, that's where the trouble starts. And another paper has really looked into both JCTO and CASEL Euro CTO score, and it shows that once you get to the higher level of complexity, see 4, 5 and 6, there is a differentiation of the success versus failure in the CASEL score compared to the JCTO score. It kind of like 3, 4, 5 have the similar failure rate. And so this is one other, the score we have available. The people always ask about the femoral versus similar success rate, except that we use more simpler lesions with the radial for the CTO, but overall success rate is similar, but lower vascular complication with the radial procedure CTOs compared to the femoral CTO. And of course, the perforation and so which occurs from open CTO is usually when you're using both approaches of the antegrade and retrograde and so. So with that note, I'll just take it to our cardiology app with Dr. Keeney, with many of them, which you are all aware of, bifurcate, octate with the
OCT. Yeah, I just, bifurcate was the first one that we have, we released, which from many people liked the bifurcate app. That is where, we started our, app journey. And then I mentioned to you Octave, the question that you had was OCT versus IVUS. So everything has been described. So what we do here is we do give some, like a textbook, a little basic knowledge of the OCT, how to perform OCT and the various images, how will you, go through the various images. Then, of course, tower cathed is one where we have to reaccess the coronaries after having done tower. Transepted is how to do transeptal puncture, especially most of the structural heart are now requiring to do perfect transeptal puncture. Now, calcificate is something that which may be useful if you're like we showed here, we had several questions about rotational atherectomy, how to perform rotational atherectomy. So, various devices for calcium, which is rotational atherectomy, then we have orbital atherectomy and the laser, which I just mentioned. Everything has been described, how to use it, how to set it up, and the various scenarios to use them. And one that we just released December 11th was STEMI cathed. It is it's a patient communication platform to transfer patients with the STEMI from the ER up to the cath lab. So this is where we are with majority of them, and all of these are available very easy. Is cardiologyapps.com. If you don't remember, just go to cardiologyapps.com. So many of them have website, and the one other thing that we don't have here is complicated. Is a web app which most of the PG students should go and visit. Complicate. What has happened is we have described over 55 cases, various complications that happen in the cath lab. We have gone through the case scenarios, gone through the cases, described the cases, essentially what are the complications and how did we manage those complications. All the complications that happened in Mount Sinai cath lab, we just grouped them into various categories and everything has been described there. Complicated, and I think it will be a good resource for most of the PG students who are listening now.
Okay, with that note, we
thank you and congratulations, Dr. Keeney, for your beautiful disposition and for your beautiful apps. We'll go through the apps, and congratulations both of you and your team for excellent demonstration of a superb case and the confidence you had in the total journey. So it is an excellent disposition of a CTO lesion, each and every step, including the different things which are to be done during the rota, during the different wear manipulations, what are the safety measures to be taken, and the ultimate journey and the ultimate result. It's a fascinating one, and congratulations both of you, not only for this case, but also the academic excursion in the form of different apps, even up to the complications. Thank you both of all.
Okay, Dr. Kali, as a part of our this morning, the evening their webcast, this meeting, I'll join you. You start your presentation. I'll join you within 5 minutes on my desktop, yeah, sure. And I'll be involved for next 1 hour. I really thank Sun Pharma and, of course, Manish to organize all this along with our Danny, our Medinbox, for this excellent demonstration. Actually, I have to say, last time they did something and pictures were not coming good. I pointed out today, the picture clarity was very good. I don't know what you want to comment on it. We actually, from here, we could see excellent clarity of the pictures. Though they did make a better change something.
Yeah, it was really superb. Even the distal LED, as if I am working in your cath lab. It's such a beautiful thing.
Beautiful. Excellent.